so we can hear our views, listen to others, and to learn in some way, freely, in the most relevant space. Tonight's debate, where we question our freedom, is the second in a series of debates, which we will be hosting here at the museum, and we encourage you to join us in these discussions. I would like to welcome all of you to the museum tonight. Thank you for taking the time out to be here, and hopefully to engage with the topic at hand. I would also like to welcome and thank our panelists for taking of their time to share and engage with us. And our moderator, Eusebius, will introduce the panelists more fully later on. Thank you to Eusebius for agreeing to moderate these panels on our behalf. Eusebius is more than likely well known to most of you, but for those of you who may not know, he has an impressive and growing track record, which includes, amongst others, being a political analyst, a broadcaster, philosopher, philosophy lecturer, and writer. His academic background is in moral philosophy. He is an associate of the Center for Ethics. As a broadcaster, Eusebius has previously presented Interface on SABC3 before hosting radio shows and amongst many other talk shows. He has written extensive social and political commentary in the local and international print media, and currently a column syndicated across the independent media. I have to read Eusebius' CV because I'll never remember all of it. He's also an author of two best-selling books, A Bunch in My Bathroom, Could I Vote DA, and his latest book, Run Races Run, has just been published, and is for sale out in the reception area. I would also like to welcome and give appreciation to two role model educators, Ms. Nikita Brown, who unfortunately is not here tonight, and she's from Fred Norman Secondary School in Innerdale, and Mr. Anthony Mgabela from Pefeni Secondary School in Orlando West. Both these educators have brought learners to the museum's events and do so on their own time with much enthusiasm, and we are very grateful for their voice. Is one Delia, ex-Fred Norman learner? Well, I'm sure he's still coming. He was one of the learners who came to our last debate last year, and of his own accord has told me, I will be there, Miss. I will be there. I need to be by all your debates. And I think if we impress one young person, some housekeeping rules. Please keep your cell phone on, but keep it on silent. Please use it to engage on social media about this event, and for Twitter, the hashtag is #ApartheidMuseum.
Thank you, Wadey. Thank you so much. Can we please give the Apartheid Museum another round of applause for putting on this event? I'm Eusebius McKaiser. I'm going to be moderating this debate. We started last year. We're hoping to have a whole series around some of the significant days on our calendar. Youth Day will be the next one that we target, a very important demographic. This is the first one for the 2016 calendar year. And I'd like to really thank you up front for coming from across the city to Joburg. I know the traffic was a nightmare. It took me 90 minutes to travel here, my guests as well on the panel. And as I was saying to one of my colleagues today at ProMedia, if we are moaning about apartheid geography, living apart, we have to live the city the way we pretend that we'd like to, and that means getting out of the northern suburbs into the south and vice versa. So we will continue to struggle and hopefully problem solve how to make sure we start on time, we get many more bodies here. But I think what's not an option is to continue to have some of these discussions in one part of this amazing African city. And so that's our vision, and that's why we are here, quite apart from the fact that I cannot think of a more emotionally appropriate setting than the Apartheid Museum for today's discussion. I'm not going to say much by way of introducing the topic, just how it is that Wadey and I came to frame it. Freedom is what we all imagined we signed up for in 1994. And tonight we are here to do several things. Firstly, to discuss our competing ideas of what success looks like. What does a free South Africa look like? What does freedom consist in? What is the benchmark against which we decide how free we are? Then I think there's another strand of conversation, which is a diagnostic conversation. How are we getting on? How well are we doing? Do many of us, especially as young people, take for granted not having the long view like some of my panelists do, of where we come from? Well, are we right to be agitated about some of the various sins in the states, in the private sector, in civil society that seem to be holding us back? So there's also a diagnostic conversation. Then, of course, I think we would be remiss not to be looking forward and to ask whether there are low-hanging fruit we might pick to mind the gap, as the full title of tonight says, between the ideal of freedom and the reality of some freedom and many unfreedoms in this city. That's all I want to say. I'm going to introduce my guests in turn as they speak. First up is Advocate George Bizos. Both George and Zuck insist that I call them that, which is a bit weird given what incredibly preeminent world-class citizens they are, quite apart from how we know them here in South Africa. He, of course, doesn't need much introduction. An absolutely incredible social justice lawyer, incredible human rights fighter, and a CV that we could talk about the whole night. And I'm sure many of you are very, very familiar with George's place in our history. A very special person to have here. And still so incredibly active. I don't want to sound ageist, but so many people are asking me, is George still coming? Because he was under hospital observation the other night, and he doesn't know what the fuss is about. In fact, he was in hospital under duress, quite frankly, he tells me. And then he also told me that he has a bad reputation for speaking over time. I reassured him that he has a reputation for speaking over time. I've never heard it described as bad. So each speaker is being allocated 10 minutes uninterrupted. I will gently nudge him, unless you're still hanging on to every single word, as you probably will. Can we please welcome Advocate George Bizos into this conversation?
What you probably don't know is that I am a refugee who came here in 1941 after the country of my birth, Greece, was occupied by the Germans. And my father, who had been mayor, took upon himself to help 7 New Zealand soldiers that had been left behind. And to cut a long story short, we were going to Crete without knowing that Crete was busy falling to the Germans. We were picked up by the British Navy in the middle of the Mediterranean, told that we could not go to Crete, but we would be taken to Alexandria in Egypt. And the Germans were about to occupy Egypt. Rommel was only 50 miles outside Cairo, and the Middle East Command took my father, me, and 143 other Greek refugees and brought us to Durban, and we came by train to Johannesburg. Not at the main station, but at Doornfontein. And when we asked why, we were told that there was a protest meeting of those who blamed General Smuts of involving South Africa with the British in a war. And Yannis Smuts was busy bringing the failhood, the rubbish of Europe to South Africa. That's enough. Because by way of contrast, Emil Combrin, the Afrikaans teacher at the Athlone High, said, Bizos, if you don't get a D in Afrikaans, you can't go to university. I'll make sure that you get a D. He was proved right. I did get a D. I served at WITS 4 terms as a member of the SRC. The SRC was consisting of 24, 22 of whom were regarded by the apartheid government as betrugers, protesters. And Malan was asked by a member of his party what was going on at this university. And Malan said he was in touch with the authorities, and he was told that there was a small bunch of protesters who were making all the trouble, but they should not worry, they would be pushed out and things would be okay. I made a speech the next day at the Great Hall in which I said, if wanted equal treatment of all our black students makes me a thing that I was called a leftist, I was proud to be one. The next day in the leading Afrikaner newspaper, headline on the front page, links has sent and trots darop, so had either George Bizos, Hester Hasse, the Great Hall from Wits University. The rest is history. I didn't see my mother for over 20 years. I was refused citizenship until 1972. I was considered to be an underground communist, particularly because I was in the case in which the Livonia accused was charged, and also counsel for Graham Fisher, the leader of the Communist Party. What evidence was there that I was really a communist, which I was not. And I never became a member of a political party. Because of a professional rule, you can't act for a party or a member of a party if you are a member. Came 1990, I got a call from Cyril Ramaphosa. George, the National Committee of the ANC, has told me that you and Arthur Chaskelson will become members of the Constitutional Committee for the Futures of South Africa. Cyril, does that mean that I have to take a card? He said, no, we don't need your 12 rands. And what do? Everything. Oh, I'll try and get you an exemption from Toy Toy. I have never Toy Toyed, but enough of this. We have a constitution, a democratic constitution, because South Africa decided in 1994, with an overwhelming majority of the people of South Africa, that we will be a democracy. Only two actually voted for the against the constitution. About 12 abstained. We are proud to say that we have a constitution which is considered by many, including us, that it is probably the best constitution in the modern world. But the question is, do we accept that we have lived up to the expectations of those that wrote the constitution, those who adopted it, those who govern us, whether they are really trying to put into effect what the Constitution expects from them? Unfortunately, not. This doesn't mean that we are not obliged to protect what the Constitution says and not to withdraw from that part of the struggle. There's nothing new in the world. Democracy, described by Plato, was ruled by the people. He actually wrote about utopia, what does not exist and never existed. The first democratic government was in Athens, but they too didn't live up to it. In fact, they actually passed a resolution, the democratic government of Athens, that the people of Mytilene, the men were to be dead, put to death, the women and children were going to be sent into exile because they did not hand over the money that had been collected from all the Greek city-states, because the Athenians wanted the money for themselves, the things that the war against the Spartans was not going very well for the historian Thucydides wrote. Thus it came to pass that the Athenians forgot about these laws of humanity that are there for everybody's protection, and forgot that they too one day may be in distress and the laws will not be able to protect them because they did not protect the laws of humanity. We mustn't make that mistake here. And we hear some people, some of them high up in government, telling us that there are African solutions for African problems. I haven't heard anybody whether the African solutions are those of Idi Amin or Mr. Mugabe or the recent visitor president that left the country surreptitiously when he had contravened international law as a mass murderer. We have to actually defend this document and what it says. and that defend the judgments of the judiciary and insist that its provisions should really govern us. It's not easy, but we should not allow statements such as, oh, but traditional law says differently. It doesn't take a very clever lawyer to say that traditional law may be not inconsistent with the Constitution, for which more than 94% of the population voted through their representatives in 1994 that it should be adopted. I think I must stop there.
But you went over by 90 seconds in perfect. We are also enormously grateful to have Gita Pether with us, who is the director of Witzer Theatre. She has a stunning career behind her already and still lots to come as a cultural activist who has had an incredibly multifaceted career in so many different spheres of society, be it television, arts, policy, as a teacher at WITS, and really turning that space into one where there's debate, where there's innovation, and has done some really good work also in corporate. You'll remember almost literally thinking outside the box of the trucks when it came to those Transnet trucks to make sure that we really take art and use it as an enabler for conversation and different ways of being. And I'm enormously looking forward to her bringing her artistic insights, and I know that this evening in particular she's going to be passionate about the economics, which I think also lies at the heart of this freedom debate, but just so much wealth of knowledge and experience. Can we please welcome her to this setting?
Thank you, and thank you for giving me this opportunity on the eve of our 22nd anniversary of our freedom. I'm old enough to remember my first act of freedom, which was an act of rebellion when I participated in the school boycott. I was 12 years old. My mum was a single parent, and security at that time even went after 12-year-olds. And I remember my headmaster at that time, Mr. Hans Mirage, said, "You know, but what are you doing this as a student leader? Do you know what you do? You understand what you're doing? Indians are like cows. They do nothing unless you put a ring through their nose and lead them." And I said, "I'm not a cow." And it was so today, as we ponder our freedoms, I'm going to. My departure point is that I think that so few facts are known about our country. We know so little of the facts that affect our day-to-day material lives, our humanity and our freedoms. And I'm going to give you what I think are the facts, and I'd like to think that they've been well researched, and let you decide whether we are free or not. Bernie Sanders, in a recent speech, said, and I quote, "The issue of wealth and income inequality is a great moral issue of our time. It is a great economic issue of our time and the great political issue of our time. Truthfully, there is something profoundly wrong when the richest 80 people of the world own more wealth than the bottom half of the global population, 3.5 billion people." It's an astounding fact, but actually he's being inaccurate. According to Forbes, it is actually 62 people in the world who own more wealth than half the world's population. We cannot talk about freedom or democracy
without talking about the economics. Who owns what in this country? South Africa has become the most unequal country in the world. The two richest South Africans, Johann Rupert and Nicky Oppenheimer, according to the Forbes report, having wealth equal to the poorest 50% of our population. So we're not talking about an arbitrary 3.5 million people in the world. We are now talking about 50% of our fellow citizens, that means you and me, they earn two people more than all that we earned combined, half our population. The Oxfam report makes other quite horrific claims, and all on the foundation of good research. Inequality in South Africa today is worse than it was at the end of apartheid. 350 billion flows out of South Africa each year illegally through corporations. Unemployment is the biggest driver of poverty and children. And poverty, especially, means that 50% of young people, including graduates, are unemployed. Now, right now, as we sit here, one in four South Africans is hungry and has nothing to eat. So we've got to measure those facts against freedom. Can anyone be free if there is one person in four people who is not, who can't have access to basic human rights that constitution is supposed to guarantee us? Over the last 20 years, we have lost 700 billion to corruption, costing each registered taxpayer 212,000 rands each. So that's money down the drain. It's called squandered funds. Accountants call it squandered funds or mismanaged funds. It's not called theft. This does not include 31 billion government bailout for the e-tolling or the 3.5 billion for the purchase of trains that don't even fit on our lines. Each year, billions are used to bail out mismanaged state or parastatals. This is SAA or SABC or the post office, and the depressing list goes on and on. I have to say, and I was talking to my nephew Rahul, who's here tonight, he said, please tell them at the start of your rather depressing speech that you do not have any political affiliation. And it is true, I've never been the card-carrying member of any political party. I despise all politicians equally. But I just, and it's not because in my heart resided at the ANC as a person growing up in the struggle and who was part of that. So my heart and my loyalty, and I felt all the euphoria that every single person who voted for the first time on the 27th of April 1994, I remember the day as if it happened yesterday. So when I speak these facts, understand it comes from a place of deep pain. It is not me trying to tell people off and where they've gone wrong. It is how I feel as a citizen of this country. I mean, this ridiculous Soriety Commission that actually has found, took 4 years, 113 million, and they found no one guilty, not even Shabir Sheikh, who was convicted on the basis of corruption around the arms deal. So the cover-ups are so colossal that it impacts on all of us. And all over the country, people are getting not ready to celebrate tomorrow. There's mass rolling protests that are happening tomorrow. We're an angry country. But it's been a long, slow burn, that it's been ignited by the Inkatha, the constitutional ruling, the apology that wasn't an apology from Zuma, the ANC's denial of wrongdoing. And suddenly it's like South Africans have sat up and said, what's happening here? How has it all come to this? And I'm saying, and that's why I orientated my speech towards the facts, know what the facts are. Because freedom is also about knowledge. You can't stand up and speak truth to power if all you're saying is, but you're not doing what you said you're supposed to do. You know, because then we start talking in abstracts. If we all understand the fact that one out of four people is hungry, 52 people own 50% of our countries, earn more than 50% of our country's population, 26.2 million people. There's something incredibly disgusting about that. In 1994, the freedom and the future of the oppressed black majority, and I count myself in it, was negotiated at the expense of justice and real and true redress in order to maintain the security and peace of mind of a white minority. It was a negotiated settlement around appeasement. And we understood it. We understood what it was at that time. And yet we held out hope that our government and our constitution would create the kind of policies and programs that would bring those freedoms enshrined in that constitution to people in real ways. In those first few years, and especially for young people, there were euphoric years. You know, we had a government that was talking, it was consulting. Consultation wasn't a tick-the-box exercise. There was robust engagement. We were hopeful. You know, I moved from Zakaria Park and 50 kilometers outside the CBD, somewhere closer. Suddenly, our lives changed. And it did change. And I do cherish the freedom. The fact that I'm sitting on this platform, being able to say what I say is a freedom. And I'm very aware of that. But I also think 22 years after our democracy and our freedom, it's time to tell the truth. And I've been accused of being a purist and seeing everything in black and white. And the truth is, the world is black and white. The truth can't be negotiated. Some things are wrong or they're right. And South Africans, we've gotten very mealy-mouthed about truth. Yes, but, you know, but he is the president, so why can't we pay $216 million for a Nkandla? But KZN has the greatest poverty levels in our country. So the inconsistencies of how we speak and the words we use and our refusal to tackle the points, the truth head on, is part of the reason why we don't grow and why freedom will elude us all. So this is a great step in them, but I have a few more facts, so let me go through them. I mean, while there's been significant strides, and we know that this was a huge job, the first ANC government, it's a huge job, and you know, the DA and all the other parties, all the people who said, you know, it's gonna go, you know, black people, they can't govern. At the beginning, you know, they were the doomsayers, everyone wanting, and people like me sitting on the sideline, the big rah-rah team on the sideline, nobody wanted this not to succeed. So why hasn't it? I think that why did the big rainbow nation, that wonderful euphoria, how did it quickly, 22 years down the line, suddenly become a banana republic in the making? Now that's a horrible word to use, because when people would talk about banana republic, they were racist generally. They wanted the whole plot to fail. And the truth is, we allowed al-Bashir to leave this country. We allowed, with Thabo Mbeki's quiet diplomacy, Robert Mugabe to ravage that country. We voted against the UN to make rape as an act of war, make it a crime. South Africa voted against it. How quickly we betray where we come from. And I think a lot of this has to be, why has this happened? I think the ANC now still sees itself as a struggle party. It hasn't evolved into a governing party. It still is bogged down in the rhetoric and sloganizing of a struggle mentality. It's even as individuals, we need to constantly subject ourselves. Am I doing this right? Was I being unkind then when I said that? We need to constantly subject ourselves to introspection, be ready to shift, to revise ourselves, to change our positions, to allow evolving challenges to shape our strategy and direction. And the ANC has always fallen back on the old. And I think it started with Thabo Mbeki. He's not my favorite person, and unfortunately neither is Cyril Ramaphosa. But then I did say, I was up front, I did say I don't like politicians. And by the way, they were all comrades, eh? So I think it started with, you know, the ANC has commandeered the struggle narrative. They would have us believe that we, the people, are reaping the benefits of their sacrifice. That the statewide corruption is the price that we have to pay for the freedom that we've gotten. And we've got to take that back. Because the ANC, yes, of course, they were leadership, they guided the struggle. But as ordinary people, we did not have the luxury of exile. You know, most of us were in the trenches. So we need to make our government, our people understand that we own our freedom. And if we want our freedom, we have to hold government accountable. And they have to talk. And I think that what disturbs me is the arrogance when government talks to us. It's like we're not allowed to ask the question. It's like a parent telling a naughty teenager to see that we all have to lead by example. We can't ask people to do what we are not capable of doing ourselves. The responsibility of freedom is to set a good example. I mean, Noam Chomsky said, you know, moral cowardice. I have to say, and this has got nothing to do with George, because as George said, he was never a member of any political party. But all the people who are talking, who are coming out of the woodwork, you know, Ronnie Castle said the other day, and I was so shocked, he said, you know, but we know Jacob, you know, is a bit of a philanderer and a bit corrupt in from the days of exile. Really? And now you're telling us that 22 years down the line? After he was almost convicted, put in jail, made him president, now you're saying it? Where was all those good people in the ANC when Thabo Mbeki, due to his AIDS denialist policy, cost thousands of South Africans their lives?
And his own contribution to our jurisprudence is very wide, and particularly in relation to socioeconomic rights. Some of you might know him in the news cycle as one of those calling for Jacob Zuma to fall at the moment. I don't know if something like that will come up tonight again, but a very important and a very thoughtful South African. And what I love about Zuck is that he doesn't just observe what's going on in society. He's one of those folks who are very reflexive about his own journey when it comes to dealing with a lot of these hard moral questions that we are facing. Can we please welcome retired Justice Zuck Yaqoo?
Indeed. I'm going to narrow the focus from the broad constitution itself to the Bill of Rights. Our constitution has many sections in it dealing with all kinds of things, but we are here concerned with those aspects of our constitution which are concerned with our value system, how parliamentarians vote and how the Electoral Commission conducts itself and so on. There are chapters and chapters which we'll have little to do with. But our Bill of Rights has in it a value system which gives our democracy a content beyond the need for us to vote every 12 months. And that Bill of Rights is not based on the value of freedom alone. Indeed, freedom as a value by itself is quite dangerous because absolute freedom at the expense of equality and dignity is the recipe for human disaster. So our Constitution is based on creating a society based on dignity, equality, and freedom. And it does not aim to do so by changing the whole fabric of our society. The negotiating process at the time was such that both parties could not get precisely what they wanted. Both sides fought very hard, and we have this constitution which we have to live with. And the object of the exercise, and some will say it's gone too far and credited to white people, My sense is that it went as far as it could possibly go at the time, and that it was a compromise which was appropriate for the time. I would have been happier if it was better, but it could not be, and that's where we live. So first we have the dignity of, we have the principles of dignity, equality, and freedom. We have the principles of our democracy. We have the principle of openness, transparency, and we have a Bill of Rights, which guarantees, and I want to clarify that in a minute, a whole range of things. It guarantees, it is written as if the rights promised in the Constitution are already here. And that's what gives rise to some of the complications. But I want to say it's the only positive way to draft a constitution. But our rights are not all here. Before, and we knew they were not there, and we all know that they were not there. We all knew that the production of a piece of paper does not produce a new society. It requires something more. So I want to start, before focusing on the negative, by saying that I find today's South Africa very, very different from post-apartheid South Africa. It's a much, much, much better country to live in. I'm telling you that the apartheid people were much worse than this ANC government. I've had experience with them both, and they were horrendous. Their immorality, their violence, their inequality, their own sense of their own corruption was absolutely speechless. The ANC is a million times better than the nationalist government could ever be. However bad you might think it is, the National Party were rogues of the highest order at every possible level, inhumane, uncaring, racist, sexist, dominant, everything that they should not be. And they were more part of the international capitalist system and its unfairness than the ANC is at the moment. So let's not get away from that. Apartheid was an absolute misery. It was a fight worth having. People in exile at that time did not live luxurious lives. They had a very difficult time being with them. So we've had this struggle, which the outside and the inside have participated in. We have the constitution. What we have today is a society which feels different, which is wonderful. It's a society in which there are more and more African people who take part in it. We are together, many of us. We do many things together. In the old days, you go to a hotel, you find everybody that speaks to you at the front desk and so on, are white people. You go to the airport, everybody is white. The name of every pilot is white. Most doctors were white. You go to on the aeroplane itself, the crew would be all white. Now, my heart feels very thrilled when I go to an airport and I see all African people, mainly, serving me and doing a very good job of it. I see African air hostesses. I see African people at hotels. I see African people occupying our town. When I walk in the streets, I brush past the people and I feel part of them. It's a wonderful thing, which would never, never have happened to me before. And then in those days, in the radio stations, only whites used to speak there. And only white people used to phone in. I don't know about the African stations, because I didn't listen to them. Now, we have people like Eusebius. Eusebius, before 1994, would have been dead. He is now here. We have many African people, many African commentators on the radio, many African opinion makers, many African writers. They're able to express themselves now. And I find all this, and a number of African people who phone in, who say, who make thoughtful comments, which are clear and straightforward, which we'd never heard before 1994, makes me know that we are at difficult times at the moment, but we are in the throes of building a new country and building it properly. And now I agree that our constitution didn't create the kind of society which some might want when you have had an equal division of wealth. But there's an affirmative action provision in our constitution which has been used to ensure that more and more people, not of colour, have gotten jobs. And we know that, and we see it every day. Of course, there are troubles at that level. We have a fair labour practice provision in our constitution which tries to effect a more appropriate balance between capital and labour, which has given trade unions the right to strike and so on. Of course, the Marikanas of this world take away from that because society is not equal, but the position is that we do have a fair labour practice provision in our constitution. We do have property reconstruction in terms of which many, many communities have got properties. We've got a long way to go. But we do have, so our society and our constitution contemplates affirmative action, contemplates restitution of property, contemplates fair labour practice, and contemplates the state doing all it can to improve and to make provision for certain social and economic rights. And my sense is that in relation to all these things, except for education and health, the housing provision has improved considerably, and we must not say no to that. The position of the workers in South Africa today is much better than it was under apartheid. Make no mistake about it. So I think that there has been progress, but there is a problem. The problem is that all of us have not studied, interpreted, and internalized the Bill of Rights. The problem is that 95% of men, in their heart of heart, they may make all sorts of noises, but in their heart of hearts, live their wide lives in a way where women are unequal. Indeed, the position is such that 90% of women also believe that they are inferior to men. 90% of people of all races think that their race is superior and the other people are worse. So we've got 99% of our people that I've met think that gay and lesbian people live in sin. So there's a huge disconnect between the values of our constitution and us. There's a big difference, but there is a huge disconnect. So what, is the constitution worth nothing then? And I've always said, and I repeat, that the constitution places on all of us the duty. Firstly, to internalize and embrace and learn the values of the constitution ourselves. Secondly, to understand that court orders won't cut it. We must try and persuade more and more people to live the values of the constitution. We must start a social revolution so that we begin to change our minds and our hearts and start thinking of lives differently. And until we have that social revolution, we're not going to get anywhere. Make no mistake, corruption is miserable. Our constitution in its essence is anti-corruption. Our leadership today, many of them are acting absolutely miserably. The dishonesty is something which is horrendous. Our health and education system is in an absolute mess. All these things are there. But I think we must all evaluate things properly, and we need to galvanize ourselves, because I was a racist and a sexist once. I promise you that if all of you exercise your minds and hearts carefully, you may find some problems deep down there which are lingering, where you feel that you are slightly superior. Know, to someone with another religion, someone who has a different sex, or you think you're a little morally better off than the guys who are gay and lesbian and so on. So the first thing is, it starts with all of us here. Let us embrace those values, and let us start the social revolution, so that if in the next 10 years we gather together and we say, if my 90% has fallen to 85%, and my 95% has fallen to 90%, which have done wonderfully well. It's a long, hard grind. It is our duty. Let us embrace the future and let us do it. Thank you very much.
Panelists, I promise you, Gita, this will be the first politician you will like. Is Bali Thuli, who is a Democratic Alliance politician. We didn't invite her as a politician, but as a South African who's young, she's still in her 20s, very thoughtful and engaging about the country, and one of those South Africans who decided to get involved in politics. She's had a bit of a national profile, leader of the DA Youth for a while, but she also has been at the coalface of governance in local municipalities in KZN. She certainly seems to be enjoying her time. Some thought that she was sent to political Siberia for fighting with some of her political elders. But I think that the experience that she has gained already sets her apart from many of us young people and us older folks who are commentarian but don't necessarily get involved in governance structures inside the state, let alone at local government level. Can we please welcome Balin Tuli to this conversation?
Good evening, everyone. I think the first thing to say is that I'm fully aware of my age and my lack of experience with the panelists that we have here today. So mine is to, at least I think, give a perspective in a political sense, but not in terms of any sort of political stance or party, and that's just because that's where my greatest time is spent. But I think it's also what we need to start really rethinking in South Africa, because we can have all of these conversations, and we can have these dialogues, and we can talk about it, and we can analyze, you know, what the problems are, and I mean, I think Gita spells out quite a lot of the realities that we know. But if we are to reach this ideal that we are talking about in South Africa, and one that was, you know, pursued from 94 onwards, I think we need to relook at the way that our political systems are structured. Because I think that one of the things in South Africa that is incredibly depressing, and one of the things that makes it so difficult for an ordinary citizen to be able to have any real stake in what is happening in this country, is that actually our public representatives don't actually represent many of the people here. And even if they don't, there's nothing that you can do to hold them accountable outside of the votes. And I don't think that's good enough. And I don't think that actually does anything, because we all know how party political lists work. And frankly, and I can even speak from my party's perspective, there is, to some degree, an element of having to toe a party line. And I think that's one of the things that's destroying both the ANC and the DA and all political movements in South Africa, because once you disallow specific people and organizations to have the space to conceptualize and put across different ways of how we need to be solving these problems, you actually are hindering them, and you are actually making them just sit there and be backbenchers and kind of just fill up the space and maybe do one or two good things in terms of service delivery for the community, but we're never going to get to a state where we can actually fully realize the freedoms that we fought for and the freedoms that we wanted to pursue after 94 if we don't change our political system. And I say this very honestly, because I myself am a politician, and I'm often frustrated with the way in which my party does things, and I often think that there's alternatives, and I often want to voice those things, and you can behind closed doors, but that means nothing, because the public doesn't get to share that, and the public doesn't actually get to be involved in those conversations and to really say which politician or which representative they feel best actually can articulate what needs to be done. And so I do think, and I'll get to it a little bit later, that we really need to relook the system of how our politics is working in this country, because I think we can all agree that that's where the most power lies, and that's where the most action can be taken to address some of these concerns that we have. But if we're not going to relook the system, then we're not going to actually change anything, and we'll continue to have these conversations, and we'll continue to bemoan the state of our economy and the state of our social ills, but without any real change. And I want to say, you know, I was in grade one in 1994, and I remember quite clearly the euphoria that Gita was talking about, and I think it was a big thing that propelled me into trying to understand politics, even outside of what my familial interest in it would have been. And it's always stayed with me how incredibly excited people were for what they thought Africa was going to bring. Little people who have the power to change the system actually seem to care the more we feel helpless and the more we slide into a situation where we aren't actually sure, firstly, what to do to change it, but secondly, what that ideal even is anymore. And I think that that's why the topic of this conversation today really appealed to me, because it was around minding the gap between the ideal and the reality, and we're all aware of what the reality is. But do we even know what the ideal of what South Africa should feel like in terms of real, true freedoms actually should be now? And it can't be the same thing that it was after 94, because I think so many of us have had that eroded in our minds that we don't truly even really believe, whether it's racially or economically, that it's something that we can continue to strive for in the way that it was envisioned at that time. But then we need to actually have something else that's in place, something that we can collectively try to be working towards. And I think you'll see that in history, the only countries that have ever really made it after these kind of either, I mean, be it colonial or be it, you know, World War II or whatever, it's only really the countries that have collectively found some sort of self-identity of what they're trying to pursue together that have actually really exceeded to some extent to achieving it. I mean, no country has fully realized freedom. But in South Africa, there's just such a disarray of what we're trying to do or where we're trying to be. And we can throw around terms like economic freedoms. Everyone wants that. We can throw around the terms that we have political freedoms. But ideally, what is this freedom and what should it actually mean and feel like for us? We have it now and people don't even know how to fully utilize it. I mean, you look at the youth that we have who can tell you that they've been able to go to a no-fee school, have been able to get access into universities, but they don't even know how to access NSFAS. Or they don't know how to, perhaps if they've gone to university and they decided to become an entrepreneur, what the next step should be. Where would they even find that in our government or in our country? How does anyone enable themselves in this country if they're not, you know, sort of in a higher class that has their services anyway, really pull themselves up by their bootstraps and utilize the freedom that we have? And on one level, I think it's because we don't have a collective sense of what we're trying to do and where we're trying to go anymore. And I think that psychologically we need to really think about how that's happened and what we're going to do about it. And I think that for that, we definitely need leaders. And I don't think that our political system right now is actually churning out leaders. We just do not have leaders that have any kind of vision of where we need to go for as this country and how they can take the most amount of people with them. And even if we didn't have that, we just don't even have people who can tell you how to use the freedom that we have now, which we have. And it's, I mean, both George and Zach and Gita have spoken about the things that we've achieved and the things that we have in our Bill of Rights and our Constitution. But too few people actually know how to utilize it, know how to make sure that it's something that can work for them. And too few of our bureaucracies know also how to measure and allocate what their job is to what people need, really. And I think that's really what we need to be talking about when we're speaking about the ideal that we're trying to get in this freedom and the pursuit. And the pursuit that we're trying to achieve, both post-94 and one that we need to re-envision for ourselves now. And I think that ultimately what happens is when you don't have something that we're all striving and collectively working towards, whether it's an individual psychological self-awareness aspect or just in terms of what Gita said, to not let one person go hungry when you know that there's enough money for all of us to have something, is that our political freedom becomes cheap. It becomes something that is there, but something that no longer actually means as much, because as generations go on, it's something that they always would have had, but it actually will start to mean nothing to them because there's nothing that they can access beyond being able to vote. And I think that that's really the critical point that we are in South Africa. You can vote, but at the end of the day, the political systems aren't even really allowing us to have a real say in what's happening.
Okay, I'm going to restrict myself to one question for each panel member. You all have 60 seconds. I'm watching on my stopwatch. In the interest of time, please keep it to 60 seconds. Then I want to throw it open to the floor so that we can have at least two rounds of comments or questions and bring it back before we invite you to then join us for further conversation and some stuff to eat outside. I'm going to start with you, Gita. I think many people might think that perhaps you were appropriately hard in your assessment of the comrades and of the state of the state. You are entitled to use 10 minutes as you wish when you get invited to any space. So this is not to say you had to focus on this, but my question is just, if you had more time, would you be as hard on other sources of power in society? Corporate, we saw the abuse of Vodacom losing a fantastic case today. Civil society. So choose to do more in reducing the gap between the have and the have-not. So I'm just wondering, you focus on the state and that's fine. Would you agree that you ought to be as hard on other sources of power?
Absolutely, and I am. And, you know, if I could stick to a script like a good theatre person, then you would have known that. The thing is, there are people who aid and abet corruption. And government is, it's big business, it's the account. accountants, it's the finance institutions, they bankroll these deals, they're complicit. So absolutely, I think corruption exists within a system. We change the system, and I absolutely agree with Imbali. By the way, I don't hate her. I think she'd be amazing. I'd vote for her. The truth is that we all become complicit, and big business, and that's why I cited my speech within the facts. Who owns power in this country? Who holds the purse strings? Government may seem to be corrupt, but they're corrupted by a system. And I agree, you know, so this is not about a rant against government. This is a rant against all of us for letting it slide to this point.
Thank you. Exactly 1 minute. Thank you for all wanting that. A good theater production. Zach, I want to ask you a question next. I was a little bit surprised by how wistfully you were talking about how much we've achieved against the baseline of apartheid. And I wasn't sure if, like a good extemporaneous debater, you were trying to position yourself against Gita, and had you not spoken, you might have had a different speech that you would have given. We can't use apartheid as the baseline for measuring success, can we, Zach?
Not the only baseline, but I think we have to know where we have come from. We can't forget that. It is a very important starting point. And there are some who have been saying recently that we would have been better off under apartheid. I've heard those comments made, and that is why I thought we should make that very clear, that our constitution ushered in for us a future which was better and is better than it was before. Obviously, it's not ideal, but I have to start by recognizing that it is much, much better, if not for our constitution. I don't know where we would have been today. So if we evaluate it, looking at the last 20 years, we have to start in 94 and compare pre-94 to now. It's wrong to say pre-94 didn't happen.
Thank you. George, I want your view on this one. Everyone has their own benchmark for how we're getting on. We see many young people. You and I were speaking outside about some of the students you've been engaging. Some young people characterize this government as a racist government, as an anti-black government, although it's black-led. Do you think young people are glib who don't have a long view of history? Or are young people right to be deeply dismayed by what we experience as the slow progress, not caring for a very long view of history?
I myself am dismayed by what has and has not happened in the last 22 years. But I want to take the opportunity, even though the only person on this platform to use the word revolution was the judge, I want to caution that violent revolutions have never really did much good. Napoleon, Lenin, Stalin, Spain, Portugal, Greece, violent revolutions before the war in particular, it really brought misery and didn't solve any problems. Social revolutions, yes, I accept. I don't want to disabuse the use of revolution. It means fundamental change. But what I appeal to young people is let us try hard. A young woman who did the master's degree at the University of Cape Town, and I'm very proud of her. I defended her father in the Delmas strike. She wrote a treatise of unpatriotic black bourgeoisie. Does that mean anything to you? So, please, don't let's divide ourselves. Nelson Mandela, with whom I was a friend from 1948 to his death, knew what he was doing in order to avoid a bloody revolution. And he managed it marvelously. He would have been very disappointed with what his successors failed to do. But let us remember what the Nelson Mandelas and Walter Sisulus and Govan Mbeki's and Brom Fishers and others really wanted for South Africa. What they did not want was a bloody revolution. Let us follow the road of Nelson Mandela, Walter Sisulu. By the way, every time I went to visit Nelson Mandela on Robben Island, would have the whole day. And I would speak to Nelson about what was happening outside and seek guidance from him, what he expected outside, both within and outside the country. His answer was invariably, George, this is the problem. I do not want to express a view. I have to discuss it with Walter Sisulu. The wise man. And I gave Sisulu Nesto as a nickname. You may not know who Nesto was. He was the only sensible Greek who was not concerned about concubines or other things during the Trojan War. He was the one that told Agamemnon and Achilles that were quarreling about who was going to have the prophet's daughter in his tent, that Nestor said, hey, we have come to win a war, not to quarrel about who is going to take the prophet's daughter into the state. So let us follow the real leaders of the struggle, and let us learn from them what we should do. He, Nelson, told the judge that was trying the 156 treason people. Mr. Mandela, asked Judge Becker, your slogan is one man, one vote. It was that. So women have a complaint to make about that, but that was. Is your organization, and this was in 60, is your organization prepared to settle for something less because we whites are afraid? And Nelson's response was, we have been knocking on the door of the white man for over 100 years. No response has come. Put something on the table and we will consider it. What I said, we said, it means my organization, not me in the witness box. And this was his dream that fundamental change would come about. It has been slow in coming about, hasn't been reached by Nelson Mandela. Don't let, even though it's posthumously, not live up to the expectation of the Susurus and Mandelas and others had. There are young people who say that Nelson Mandela betrayed the struggle. Nonsense. We would have had a bloody revolution if it was not for his wisdom and those of his colleagues that really started the struggle. Certainly in the middle 50s and even before in the middle 40s when Nelson Mandela joined the youth league. Let's look at our history and don't let us be unduly influenced by people who do not know the history, who do not know the difficulties and do not know the wisdom of those who are really responsible for our freedom and our constitution.
Thank you, George.
We have the utmost responsibility to actually, despite where we may have come from and how hard it may have been to get us here, to ensure that the next person who comes behind us is not going to have to endure those certain struggles. And so there must be some sense of class suicide, as some people say. Or just us realizing that the struggle is not going to end with us. And if we think we're going to realize all of these things that we're talking about now, then we are definitely not going to succeed because we're going to be chasing the wrong thing. And I think that's important for us as South Africans. And it's very difficult to think, but it's just going to have to be the role that some of us may play if we are not able to accelerate the rate of what we're trying to do in the time that we have. And the second thing that I wanted to just touch on, there were lots of questions, but the ones that stood out for me was, what do we do now, and the economic question. And I think that economically, as Gita was saying, and I think that we all know, we have money in South Africa. We're probably one of the best resource countries in the world if we could actually utilize what we have in the best kind of way. And so that concern in terms of allocations and all that, it's not because we don't have, it's just because, one, it's in the hands of a very few individuals, and two, because then the rest is just utilized incorrectly.
I think there is a strong argument for saying that the political party discipline is inconsistent with the Constitution, because the Constitution requires everybody to keep to the oath that they took in Parliament, and therefore parliamentarians have a different duty. I'd like to see whether someone takes up the case and whether we get somewhere. So I think that that role is not really too far away. I don't think that you can listen to your party. You know, our Constitution says even an army person is not supposed to obey an unlawful order. Well, now, how can you do what your political party tells you to do if you think it is dishonest and keep to your oath of office at the same time? It's quite an interesting, complicated question. But having said that, I want to say that there are three levels. The first level is our constitution. And there are some who say our constitution is no good. My view on that is very clear, that our constitution is the best we could have achieved at the time. And until such time that we can change it, it does offer a way of changing our society. It does offer us the opportunity to change our hearts and minds and to work things through. So I would still say that all of us must learn the values of our constitution. All of us must embrace it. All of us must live in accordance with it. We must change ourselves, change others, and as a slow process, we will get the social change, or social revolution, as I choose to call it, in society. As far as the politics are concerned, I agree that politics are very dirty in this country at the moment, and all of us will have to decide. I have decided, and all of us will have to make these decisions, and the decisions you make will mean hard work, will mean taking risks. I have taken the risk, and I have decided to fight against our president publicly. That will have its consequences, I have no doubt it will. And we'll face them when they come. So in a sense, all of you will have to decide in their own hearts how you are going to tackle things. Depends on your analysis. My evaluation is that there are still enough good people in the ANC, maybe, to put it right. I think that Zuma and many people in the ANC are responsible for the current trouble, that our constitution is for honesty, and obviously there are too many dishonest people within our system. The problem is our parliamentarians, and no one knows our constitution, and that's a problem. So I think, firstly, let us all implement our constitution properly to put that right, and secondly, let us do what we can to exert as much pressure as we possibly can. And that exerting pressure won't mean just coming to talk here. It may entail sacrifice. When we exerted pressure in those days, we made sacrifices, we went to jail. So I'm saying be prepared to make sacrifices. Not necessarily having violence, but do everything that is right, face the consequences of your actions, and if you are prepared to make sacrifices, really prepared to do so, you will effect that political change that you want. But each of us will have to decide for ourselves what to do about that, and that has little to do with the Constitution.
Any political reporters present? Did you get the news angle?
Yes.
Okay, I'll break it tomorrow at 7:02 at 9 o'clock. Thank you for that, Justice Yakub. I think it's high time that we actually examine not just the political cost of the party system, but indeed ask the question whether it is in line with the Latin spirit of constitutional equipment of backbenchers. I almost said ANC backbenchers, any backbencher. Gita?
Thank you. I think the obstacle to our freedom is some almost mass inability to deal with the facts. I know that when you point a finger, four fingers point back, but the role of responsible citizenry is to understand what is at stake and to be prepared, not to take up arms, but certainly to stand up for what is right. I think that we have been lulled into this allowing everything to take care of itself. Freedom has to be about us taking responsibility for it. And I have to say that if a lot of my remarks were about putting the facts before you, I think they get lost in the morass of media headlines. They get lost in the rhetoric. We forget that they're real people, and all this thing has impact for real people in real time. And I also, as part of a nationwide movement to call government to account, I think we have to make our voices heard in our work. And as human beings, I'm first of all an artist, and I operate from a place of understanding the difference I make in the lives of the people immediately around me. So whether it's young people or statements made through the art that I produce, that is where I interact. Mbali has chosen to be a politician, and I admire her for taking that up. We all have our places and our spaces to occupy and shape if we want to be part of that South Africa we envisage, where freedom is not debated and its very existence is not debated. So for me, it's all about personal responsibility. It's about being a responsible citizen. Now, I also want to make it very clear that I'm not anti-government. As I said at the outset, my very ability to say what I want today comes because of that government, because of that struggle. But I will not apologize for demanding absolutely the highest standards from them. The standards that I demand for myself and from myself, I will demand from my government. I don't think they are black standards, and I don't think they are white standards. They are only human being standards. We all have to be judged by the same measure, and we should not be afraid
to hold government up, ask them to fulfill that. Yeah, good.
Thank you.